We're back with Dr. Ed Oh to talk more about short-term memory. So Ed, we wanted to talk more about the neuroscientific basis of short-term memory. So where in the brain does short-term memory arise from?
It's a good question, and it's a little bit complicated to answer because short-term memory capacity is probably determined by a large number of parts of the brain. But there has been a lot of recent research that points towards a primary role in the posterior parietal cortex of the brain. So, for example, electrophysiological measurements of the brain's activity while people are holding visual information in working memory shows that there is sustained electrical activity over the parietal cortex, which is actually directly related to the amount of information that people can hold in mind. And it turns out that looking with functional magnetic resonance imaging, they can find activity in the same region of the brain showing similar properties. That is, the activity rises as more and more information is entered into working memory, and importantly, it stops rising when a person has reached their capacity limit. So the activity is directly tied to memory capacity as opposed to just mental effort or other things that make tasks difficult.
Do you see the same level of activation in that area of the brain when people have reached their limit for different people who have different limits, such that people with a higher limit have more activation, or do you see the same level of activation once they've just reached their limit?
It does differ from one person to the next, and I think this is one of the things that suggests the power of this kind of measurement technique. That is, a person with high memory capacity does indeed show neural activity in this region of the brain that rises for a larger number of items than for a person that can't hold that much information. This sort of makes sense. If you have a memory capacity, for example, of only one item, and you add a second item to the display, it turns out you've not added any information into memory, and so you might not expect the neural signature of storage to be increased in that case. But if you take a subject who has a memory capacity of four items, then when you've added that second item in, you've indeed doubled the amount of information in memory, and the neural signature of that storage process also shows an increase in its amplitude.
So what about verbal short-term memory, like auditory short-term memory? Does that happen in the same area of the brain? Do you see activation there, or is it elsewhere?
Well, there have been many different kinds of neuroimaging studies over the last 10 or 20 years in humans that have tried to examine exactly which parts of the brain are involved in memory for different types of information. And in almost every study that I'm aware of, the parietal cortex has been one of the key players in memory for different types of information. So while there are some differences in how the brain is activated during memory for different types of information, it seems like the parietal cortex, among a few other players, is a pretty constant signature of working memory.
Would you say that the differences between activation are more to do with perception systems than the actual memory?
That is a possibility. So we've been talking about the parietal cortex and its relationship to the number of items that a person can hold in memory. But of course, there are other regions of the brain that are activated when people are remembering things. There was a recent study by Zhu and Chen in which they found the same activity that I've just described in the parietal cortex that corresponded to the number of things that their subjects were asked to remember. But they found activity in different visual areas of the brain, in the lateral occipital cortex and other regions of the brain, that seemed to be more affected by the complexity of the items that people were being asked to remember. And one possibility is that activity in these other regions of the brain is related to their ability to store the visual details of the items that they are remembering. So we have entertained the hypothesis that perhaps the parietal cortex is a system which may determine how many things a person can remember, perhaps regardless of what kind of information they may be storing, while other parts of the brain are more specifically dedicated in their role towards different types of information, such that memory for faces and objects, for example, may be related to a more ventral part of the visual cortex in the lower part of the brain, while memory for actions or locations may instead involve other parts of the visual system in the dorsal processing stream.
So in terms of neuroplasticity, do you think that you could increase your clarity by becoming more expert in a field? Or is that more that you're just better at chunking things?
Yes, I believe that you can improve your clarity, and there have been some direct studies of this exact question. So there was a study published by Kim Kirby and Isabel Gauthier, where they were examining memory for upright faces compared to memory for upside down faces. And the reason they used those stimuli is because it's well known that people are extremely good at telling the difference between upright faces. Luckily for us, because it's a socially important ability for us to be able to recognize our friends and associates and tell subtle distinctions. However, another thing that's known is that if you turn a face upside down, even though exactly the same low-level visual features are there, now people are very bad at being able to tell the difference between those faces. So their expertise and practice at identifying faces kind of goes out the window once you turn those faces upside down. Well, they used this to study working memory and how it might be affected by expertise, suggesting that upright faces would tap into people's perceptual expertise for faces, while upside down faces would kind of cancel that benefit. And what they found was that in one of these simple change detection memory tasks, people were indeed much better at holding the information and responding accurately with the upright faces than they were with the upside down faces. Interestingly, we did a follow-up to that study and found that the reason for the improved performance with the upright faces was because they had a more clear memory of the upright faces than they did of the upside down faces, whereas the number of upright faces that they could hold was actually the same as the number of upside down faces that they could hold. So one answer is that by training perceptual precision, by becoming an expert in perceiving a particular class of items, you can improve your resolution in memory for that same kind of information.
So what about improving your general capacity then? Is there any way to do that? Are you stuck with what you're working with?
Can we increase the number of items that a person can hold in mind? This has been a topic of great interest over the last several years. And in fact, there have been a number of different studies published looking at training effects. That is, can we have behavioral training interventions that will improve intellectual functioning as measured by IQ tests and memory tests and tests of attention? And it seems like there's reason to be optimistic. That is, that various interventions have been shown to have a reliable effect on performance in demanding attention and memory tasks. The more precise question, or the more specific question, of whether we've increased the number of things that a person can hold in working memory, or whether we have instead increased the clarity of those memories, this is a question that still requires more research. I think that a direct study of that question is not available yet.
So in the opposite direction, what kind of brain damage will result in deficits in clarity or capacity?
Yeah, that's a good question. That is, which parts of the brain seem to really be necessary for determining how many things a person can remember, for determining their memory capacity. And I believe a number of studies have shown that damage to this parietal region of the brain that we've discussed does indeed lead to deficits in people's ability to hold information in short-term memory. However, it's also important to remember that there are other parts of the brain that participate in these kinds of memory processes, and it's very likely that other parts of the frontal cortex and even subcortical regions like the basal ganglia are going to be important for people's ability to determine the contents of memory and to maintain items in memory. So my guess is that careful study would show that damage to a number of different regions of the brain, including the frontal and parietal cortex and other regions, would lead to problems with maintaining information in short-term memory.
You keep mentioning other regions. So aside from the parietal cortex, what are some other main regions that seem really important?
The prefrontal cortex would be another region which is typically activated when people are holding information in short-term memory, and many have hypothesized that this prefrontal region may be helping to determine what information is stored in the parietal cortex, sort of like a traffic director. And so one would hypothesize that damage to that system will create damage in controlling what are the contents of working memory. And that is a key aspect of success in these kinds of memory tasks.
So you've spoken about how the parietal cortex is important for storing information. What other areas of the brain are important for the clarity of that information?
I think that here we could refer to a hypothesis that's been kind of emerging in the literature for some time. And it came after many different neuroimaging studies and studies in animals as well, repeatedly find that areas of the brain that are involved in seeing or encoding a stimulus from the environment also seem to be activated when an individual is trying to hold that information in memory. So, for example, if you ask somebody to perceive a set of objects or faces, then you will find that that act of seeing those things will activate regions in the temporal cortex of the brain, which is known to participate in object encoding. Well, if you now ask them to remember those items for several seconds, then what you'll find is sustained activity in the same part of the brain that participated in the encoding of that information. And some people have referred to this as a sort of sensory recruitment, the idea that working memory is co-opting the parts of the brain that perceive the world to be able to also store what is perceived when the person no longer has access to that information.
So you've spoken about how perceptual systems are involved in maintaining memory and short-term memory. Is that the same with retrieving memory from long-term memory? Do you see the same systems being activated, or?
Yeah, there are various tasks that people have used where they ask people to retrieve information from memory, long-term memory, and then to hold an image of that in mind for a certain period of time. Neuroimaging studies here again have demonstrated that the regions of the brain that participate in the perception of the information that is being imaged are also activated during the voluntary retrieval of those images from long-term memory. So the general story seems to be that we have some kind of voluntary control over the activity in our sensory and perceptual systems. And we can control what is represented by those systems by trying to hold it in memory, by trying to hold a mental image for a certain period of time. We can actually recruit those sensory systems to engage a representation that's useful to us.
So what is the benefit of studying the neural basis of these systems rather than just the behavioral basis?
For a very long time, most of our knowledge about how psychology and mental processing worked was based on behavioral studies, where we would determine what made tasks difficult, what made people more or less accurate or more or less quick at responding to different tasks. And I believe that that is a key source of evidence. And it's still important for neural studies of psychology as well, because we have to use those behavioral methods in neural studies. The neural studies basically provide us with an entirely new set of clues about what must be true, about how the mind works. And more clues are better than fewer clues. So I think that's one obvious way where neuroscience has benefited our understanding of working memory and other mental processes. Also, in some cases, there are certain kinds of evidence we can get from studying neural systems which are just not possible to obtain with behavioral responses. For example, some people have wondered whether or not there is in fact a separate working memory system that is not just a simple subset of long-term memory. That is, we know that we have long-term memories. There's information that you have that you could retrieve from many years ago that you're not currently thinking about, for example. The question then is, do we have a separate memory system, or is there a qualitatively different process involved in keeping information active in your mind for a short period of time? And these neural studies have demonstrated that there are brief, sustained periods of neural activity that correspond exactly to what people are holding in mind, and that seem to provide more of a vivid picture of the brief process that we think is going on when people hold information temporarily. And I think that really solidifies the construct for us.
Okay, well, I think we've covered the topic of the neural basis of short-term memory pretty well.